Hello, everybody. Welcome to our morning worship on Sunday, October the 15th. This service is brought to you by St. Thomas à Becket Church, Ramsey. My name is Ian Osborne. I'm the rector of the parish. This morning's online worship will be a quite simple and short. We have changed the way we're producing these. This is perhaps a good moment to let you know we are thinking quite hard about whether it will be possible to sustain producing these services after I've finished in the parish at the end of 2023. Those of you who join us regularly will be used to seeing my face more than anyone else's, and we're not sure we've got the staffing to keep producing these. We will keep you posted, but it would be useful to know. Perhaps you might want to put a comment in the comments, how you would feel perhaps about using some of the material that the National Church of England publishes, or whether you'd prefer something very, very simple, just a few prayers read it onto a recording. We welcome your thoughts as we consider what's going to be possible. Anyway, here we are today, not at the end of the year, but in October. I'm going to begin. Let's begin today's service just with a word of prayer. Lord, we have come together to worship you, to reflect on your goodness and your way in our lives and in the world. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us as we pray together. Amen. Let's begin with a hymn. Reading today is from the book of Isaiah, a wonderful reading that looks forward to God acting in sovereign power. On Mount Zion, the Lord who rules over all will prepare a feast for all the nations. The best and richest foods and the finest aged wines will be served. On that mountain, the Lord will destroy the veil of sadness that covers all the nations. He will destroy the gloom that is spread over everyone. He will swallow up death forever. The Lord and King will wipe away the tears from everyone's face. He will remove the shame of his people from the whole earth. The Lord has spoken. At that time, they will say, "He is our God. We trusted in him and he saved us. He is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us be filled with joy because he saved us." Isn't that a wonderful reading? This image of God preparing a feast, a banquet, is one that comes up over and over again in the Old Testament. And then Jesus tells lots of parables, which kind of seem to symbolize this feast that God will have at the end. And at the very end of the Bible, in the book of Revelation, the happy ending for the whole of the world is symbolized with the wedding feast of the Lamb. The best and richest foods, the finest aged wines will be served. Whether you like that image or not, the prophet then is very direct. The Lord will destroy the veil of sadness that covers all the nations, destroy the gloom that is spread over everyone, swallow up death, will wipe away our tears. So, very simply this morning, I invite you to consider first what makes you sad and what makes us sad, the nations, the whole world, the veil of sadness. It's in the nature of an online service that I don't know the situation that you're sitting in. Some of you, I'm sure, I know your health has given way and you're not able to do the things you used to do. Some of you might be quite lonely. I know some, at least, of you are sitting amidst a landscape that has been ravaged by natural disaster. Still, I'm sure, rebuilding your life and feeling very bruised. I'm recording this in the still shell-shocked by the news from the Gaza Strip. The horror that is the inevitable result, I think, of bottling people up and ignoring them and depriving them of hope. The people of Gaza have been treated terribly for many years, and now they have shared their distress on others and done terrible things to the people living around in southern Israel. It's not difficult to think of what creates the veil of sadness. What makes us feel better? It's partly other people, I think, on a personal level, the company of other people, particularly those we love, a hug or a touch. It's partly knowing that people often behave well. It's partly hope. Human beings struggle to live without hope. That's part of what explains the explosion from the Gaza Strip, that those people were deprived of hope. This passage looks forward, above all, hopefully, to a time when God will change the rules of the game, when he will close everything down and start it up again. Jesus could have done that on the cross. I think his disciples expected that he would, at that time, bring in the full reign of God. If he had done that, then not many of us would be round the table at the banquet. Instead, God, in mercy, has allowed a space in which the peoples of the world can turn to him and accept the gospel. But this time will come. That's the teaching of the church. So I've asked you what makes you sad and what makes you feel better. I think my third question is, what do you really expect from God? I know that for many Christians, it is really hard to enter into this belief that God will indeed wind everything up and begin again. And if you're one of those people, I think what I would say is not necessarily, you know, cross your fingers and hold your breath and try very hard to believe it, even though you don't. But allow this possibility to continue to haunt your life. Consider, even if you don't expect it, consider what it would be like. Think about it. And see if you can make connections between the work of God as you see it in your life, in the world today, and this promise of a fresh beginning in which all tears will be wiped away. And in the meantime, we know the love of God in prayer. We meet with God in Holy Communion. That's another bit of symbolism about the banquet. And in the love that we encounter from other people, one another. We'll just turn now briefly to God in prayer. Lord, we lift to you first of all ourselves, the things in our life that cause us suffering, the things that other people might have done to us, the things that in our own sin or short-sightedness we've done to ourselves. The sadness that we live fragile, broken lives in bodies that age and fail. All of our tears, Lord, we lift to you. We pray that we will know your presence with us, that through turning to you, paying attention to your word, we will know where we can be comforted. We pray for others we know who are suffering, who are ill or anxious or in trouble. Those who can't make ends meet. We pray that you will be very close to them, and that through your servants in the world, through your church, they will receive help. And we lift to you, Lord, the all of suffering that hangs over the world, sadness. Because we have constructed a society that is so heartless. Because we are doing terrible damage to the planet. Because of the ways that men and women fail to appreciate and love one another. That people of different races treat each other badly. For the historical griefs of colonialism or slavery. All of this, Lord, we lift to you. We pray that you will untie the knots. We pray particularly this week for peace, justice, reconciliation between all the peoples of the Middle East, and particularly those who have lost their lives, those who live now in fear because of the outbreak of violence around the Gaza Strip. We look, Lord, to your salvation. Give us hope, Lord. Fill our hearts with hope that you will act and that all tears will be dried away. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Shall we say together the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We'll end with a blessing. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and all you love, now and to eternal life. Amen. Have a good day.